Hello and welcome to a special interview for The Wire. The situation in Maharashtra has raised certain critical questions to do with the constitution, the law, as well as propriety. And those are the very issues I shall raise today with one of India's foremost lawyers, former Attorney General Mukul Rohatgi. On Sunday, Mr. Rohatgi appeared for unnamed BJP MLAs and independents in the Supreme Court. On Monday, he also appeared for Devendra Fadnavis. Mr. Rohatgi, let's start with the governor. I'll go stage by stage through it. When a governor calls upon the legislature party leaders of two parties that were opponents and fought against each other in the elections, and in fact were allied with other parties, to form a coalition government together, does he need to ascertain that the alliance they're creating is A, genuine, and B, it actually has the numbers to form a majority?
See, the governor has absolute discretion in selecting the leader and the party which he feels will give a stable government. He can invite them. If obviously there are two parties, the pre-poll alliance, as was there in this case, and if they were together, it was all hunky-dory. But in this case, from 24th of October, the allies turned four and nobody was willing to put his hat in the ring. The governor actually, after 10 odd days or 15 days, asked each of them, will you come forward? It's not his job to go fishing for, asking parties. But he did so. Nobody came, so he imposed precedent rule. Then, as I saw the governor's papers today in the court, on 22nd of November, Mr. Fadnavis gave a letter saying that I will form the government with the NCP. He gave a list of 105 BJP MLAs, obviously, who were with him, some 18 or 19 independents, and along with that, a letter by Mr. Ajit Pawar, who is the NCP's legislative party leader, saying that I support the government of Fadnavis, and here are 54 signatures in support thereof.
Can I interrupt at this
yes.
point? What was happening is that two parties that were foes during the elections and opposed each other
yes.
were now coming together
yes.
in an alliance.
Yes.
But so this is the point.
Pre-poll, they were foes. Post-poll, they got together.
But this is what I'm questioning. Did they get
yeah.
together? Because you see,
yes.
according to the Hindu,
yes.
the BJP staked a claim with NCP support
yes.
at 10 minutes past 12
yes.
on Saturday morning.
Yes.
Exactly 5 hours earlier, Sharad Pawar, who's the president of the NCP, had
yes.
publicly said on television
yes.
that the NCP is supporting Uddhav Thackeray. So shouldn't the governor have asked, who is the NCP actually supporting? Your party president says Uddhav Thackeray. The legislature
Look,
party
Karan,
leader says Devendra Fadnavis.
The governor has no means of investigation. He has to go by what is presented to him. And what was presented to him was 105 plus 19 MLAs plus 54. He had the signatures and he was right in calling them by saying, even if you are foes, you are now together and 170 can give you a stable government.
Except for the fact that the governor should have known, must have known. In fact, it's impossible to say he didn't know that Sharad Pawar had 5 hours earlier on national television committed himself to supporting Uddhav Thackeray.
Yeah, so
in fact,
Karan,
let me add, Saturday's papers, which get published at 6 in the morning, and the government was only sworn in at 7:50, every single paper's main front page story was that Uddhav Thackeray will be chief minister with NCP support.
True.
So at that point, the governor should have said, what is the true situation? Are you supporting Uddhav Thackeray or is your support party supporting Devendra Fadnavis? If he doesn't ask that question, he's allowing himself to be misled by Ajit Pawar.
No, so there are two answers to that. One, Mr. Ajit Pawar was the legislative party leader of the NCP, authorized with 54 signatures. Mr. Sharad Pawar did not have 54 signatures. The man authorized, like an authorized secretary, is Ajit Pawar with the signatures. He had it before him, number one. So he accepted it, and as it happens, as per the law or the constitution, he has to tell them to take a flow test and then prove whether he was right or he was wrong.
One more point. The governor accepted the claim made by Ajit Pawar.
Yes.
The governor either wasn't aware of, which is hard to believe, or he disregarded the fact that 5 hours earlier, Sharad Pawar had actually said we're supporting Devendra Fadnavis. However, what the governor did know is that Sharad Pawar and Ajit Pawar were clearly supporting two different people for the same job. And therefore, the governor should have said to himself, is this party split? And secondly, he should have said, who has the majority of the MLAs?
No,
did he ask that question?
I agree.
So you agree? You agree?
No, I agree with you that this 7 o'clock in the evening happened and this happened at midnight. But the fact of the matter is, assuming he saw the TV, he saw Sharad Pawar giving a press conference. But what was before him was a fact with letters. It's possible that between 7 and 12, one Pawar and the other Pawar got together and gave a letter. So
did the governor verify that after 7 o'clock, the two of you got together?
He need not verify. He has no investigative agency. He has no adjudicatory role.
He has a curiosity and he has a mouth to ask intelligent questions.
True, but he is nobody to ask. If two people go and say, I have 170, he will accept unless he has a doubt about the signature, about whether it's false or whether it's not false. If it's not false, he's jolly well bound
to call. Mr. Rohatgi, it's not just that Sharad Pawar said this on television, but as I pointed out, the papers which come out at 6 in the morning, an hour and 50 minutes before the swearing in, every single paper's front page story was that Sharad Pawar is supporting Uddhav Thackeray. At that point, at least, the governor should have said, is there a problem in your party? Are you split?
Karan, that it was much past that. As you said, at 12 at midnight, they staked a claim. He verified the signatures with his eyes that they were 54, 105 and 19. He was prime officio satisfied. He recommended dissolution of president rule. The president rule was revoked upon his recommendation. After revocation, he invited.
But do you know what you're saying? You're saying that the governor deliberately disregarded everything else he knew from TV and the papers, which contradicted what Ajit Pawar was claiming. And by deliberately disregarding it, he allowed himself to be in a position where he was misled by Ajit Pawar.
Why do you say he was misled?
Because he didn't use the knowledge that was available to him to question as if it was misleading.
See, the question is, how did Ajit Pawar have 54 signatures? I ask you this question.
Surely an intelligent governor would have said, have you obtained these genuinely? Were they obtained for some other purpose? The account from television by Sharad Pawar and the newspaper stories would have suggested that in fact these signatures were obtained not for Devendra Fadnavis, but for in fact Uddhav Thackeray. Surely an intelligent, cautious, responsible, careful governor would have questioned.
I don't think he has any power to question.
Why
number
not?
One. Number
Why
one.
Not?
Unless he has reason to doubt these signatures.
But he has reason.
I saw the signatures.
But Mr. Rohatgi, I'm giving you good reasons to doubt the claim made by Ajit Pawar.
But Karan, even today, none of the lawyers on the other side doubted the signatures. Even today. So all
it's
this...
It's not the doubt of the signatures I'm claiming. I'm saying he should have doubted for what purpose were they obtained, because clearly Sharad Pawar is suggesting they are meant for Uddhav Thackeray. Ajit Pawar is presenting them as if they're meant for the Devendra Fadnavis.
Sharad Pawar never said at 7 p.m. in the evening I have signatures for Uddhav.
An intelligent person would have naturally assumed that these signatures are obtained for one purpose and are being presented for another. A cautious, responsible governor would have asked these questions, yet he didn't. What I'm saying to you is he had information available, good information, to doubt what Ajit Pawar was claiming. He didn't use it. And by not using it, he's actually allowed himself to be misled. And that is a horrible position for a governor to end up in.
See, if a person is misled, then obviously it's a bad thing. But in this fact scenario, when he is faced actually with these documents and signatures of the largest party, mind you, it's not only the Ajit Pawar going and saying, I'll form the government. Ajit Pawar was asked earlier, 10 days earlier, he said, I can't form. So the governor is faced with the position that the largest party, he's normally supposed to call the largest party, 105 plus 19, 124 already there, magic figure is 144. The largest party, the leader of BJP, former chief minister, goes to him and says, I have the support of this Ajit Pawar and the signatures. Where is the question of the governor doubting them?
Well, I've just given you several reasons why a good, careful, responsible governor would have, but you're saying, in fact, he didn't. And I'm pointing out to you that even if today's verdict doesn't say it, history's verdict is likely to be that Governor Koshyari behaved irresponsibly. He had good reason to doubt and he didn't use it. He allowed himself to be misled, and therefore, instead of living up to the standards required under the Constitution, he's let the Constitution down.
I don't think so at all. A governor is not meant to go only by what newspapers say or what TV says. Every day people make all kinds of claims. He's not supposed to act on newspapers or TV. He's supposed to act on hard facts. He had the hard facts.
Let me go one step further. It's not just that the BJP claimed it had NC support in very uncertain, unclear circumstances. In addition, at the time, president's rule was prevailing in Maharashtra and there was absolutely no rush to have to form a government. The governor had as much time as he wanted to verify. Yet, what did he do? He sent an order to Delhi recommending the revocation of president's rule at 10 past 2 at night, and at 7:50 in the morning, he'd sworn in a new government. Was that the proper and correct way to behave in such a daring rush?
Look, let us start from the basics. A governor's rule is anathema to the Constitution. The Constitution says there must be democracy. Governor's rule is the last alternative. The earlier it goes, the better it is.
In such a tearing rush at 2 o'clock at night?
Well, suppose it was not 2, it was 5 o'clock in the morning. Suppose the swearing in was at 10 in the morning, what difference will it make? So let's not go by 2 o'clock or 8 o'clock. The problem is, in courts I see, if the government takes too long, you are blamed for being...
Do you remember how the Manmohan Singh government was sharply criticized for sending documents at night to President Kalam in Russia at the time of the dissolution of the Bihar Assembly? Exactly the same thing seems to have happened here.
This is not Russia, it was Bombay and Delhi. You send it by fax.
Nonetheless, at night. Let me put it like this. This is not illegal. This is not unconstitutional, but is it fitting and proper that a governor should be entertaining claims to stake and form a government in the dark hours of the night? And secondly, that he should be swearing in a government in the early hours of the morning, both done almost by secret, without any public notice, without any publicity?
Look, as I said, the fact that it should go away at the earliest is what the law prescribes. He was waiting from 24th of October. No party was coming forward. He asked people to come forward. On 9th of November, he had no option because the period of the last assembly expired. From 9th onwards, we reached 22nd. It could have been 23rd, it could have been 22nd, could have been 24th. The fact of the matter is, he got a chance to have a government and he went for it.
Now, just a moment. If he had given himself a bit more time, which he could have without causing any problem, he would have been able to better verify whether there was a genuine alliance between BJP and NCP. He would have been better able to verify whether the party had split and whether there was actually the two-thirds with Ajit Pawar. None of that did he give himself time to
do. Not two-thirds, he had all.
And in fact, well, he claims he had all.
I saw the signatures, all of them.
At that time, we believe that signature may have been intended for other purposes, but let's not go into that, we've been through that. Is it fitting and proper for a governor in midnight hours, A, to entertain a claim to form a government, and then B, swear in that government in the early hours just after dawn, with no one in the world knowing, total secrecy? Do you know what they're saying on TV? They're saying, chupke, chupke, chori, chori. Is it fitting that he should have put himself as governor into this position of being accused of chori, chori?
I personally don't think that there's anything wrong, except, as you say, it's a little odd it has happened in this fashion.
Is it fitting and proper? Is it dignified?
I don't think there's anything wrong.
There's nothing wrong?
Nothing wrong.
This is perfectly dignified?
It's perfectly dignified. It's proper because there was no option but to accept it. Nobody else was coming.
Was the rush to have to form a government there and then at midnight? Let me put it like this. I agree with you that President's rule is an anathema to the Constitution. However, President's rule has been imposed several times by the BJP as well in states like Arunachal Pradesh and Uttarakhand, where in fact the Supreme Court overturned it. So it's not something that the BJP doesn't like doing, they've done it. Now, it is an anathema, but there isn't a timeline or a rush to get rid of it. And certainly, you don't have to do it at midnight. Give yourself a day or two, find out the proper situation, actually ascertain whether really are two foes coming together, because the concept of foes coming together itself is so unusual, a governor should have asked himself, is this true? Is there a bit of a game here? Is this a gimmick? Am I being misled? None of that did he ask.
The final test is the flow test.
But that's always the case.
It's always the case. Therefore, all he had to see was, does he have the numbers? Does he have the numbers in his hand? Or is it just a claim in
but
the air?
But if he calls people to form a government without a rational, good basis for doing so, then he's giving them an advantage by the time the floor test comes. That's what he may have done here. And that's why people find it repugnant.
I don't think he did anything foolhardy. He had the right material. He exercised his discretion. All you can say is it should have been 5 hours later. But that's neither here nor there.
Let's come
question
to the,
is it legal or is it not legal?
Let's come that's to all. The manner in which this swearing-in happened. Normally, as you know, a swearing-in in India is a ceremonial occasion. Celebrities and dignitaries are invited. On this occasion, the Chief Justice of the State and the Chief Secretary of the government weren't there because they weren't aware it was happening. More importantly, Doordarshan, the national broadcaster, wasn't invited to telecast it. This was left to a private organization called ANI. This clearly smacks of stealth, haste and cutting corners. Is it in keeping with the spirit of the Constitution? Not the letter, I accept. The spirit, which should be as important to a governor.
The spirit doesn't say that you must call A, B or C or have it at 12 o'clock in the morning. I mean, I don't have those facts.
But see, not chupke, chupke, chori, chori.
No, it's not chupke, chupke, because once he swears it in, and even if you call ANI, it's going to be known after 1 hour. So it's not something he can keep under wraps forever. I can understand if you keep something under wraps forever. You can say it's a little odd that he went that fast. But maybe
a little odd that he went that fast. You've brought yourself around to concede that.
Only because, look, we have had sittings of courts on Sundays, like yesterday. We have had sittings at 1 o'clock at night. I mean, I said yesterday to the court, why are you sitting on Sunday? What's so great about this case? He says, no, we will sit. So this is a matter of the perception. That's about all. Nothing else.
Let me put this to you. The governor was in a tearing rush to revoke president's rule and to swear in a new government. Having sworn in the new government, he's given them 14 days to prove their majority. Isn't there a contradiction in that? A tearing rush to bring them in. You can't even wait 6 hours to verify whether their claim is genuine and they have the numbers, and yet you then give them 14 days to prove their majority.
It is solely within his discretion.
Of course it is, but is it not contradictory?
No, many times it is given. 7 days, 10 days, 14 days, many times. It's nothing new.
But I'm saying compare it to the tearing rush with which he revoked President's rule and swore
them
in. There he wasn't prepared to give himself time to verify and check, right? And he could have ended up being misled. Many people believe he has been misled.
Right.
But having done it, he then gives them 14 more days.
He could have given 8, 10. Where do you draw the line? The Constitution doesn't say.
You know what people say?
Hmm.
And this is being said publicly, not just by opposition politicians, not just by analysts on TV, but by Aam Janta. That these 14 days are a gift to Mr. Fadnavis to lure, buy, poach and horse trade, to lure and buy MLAs.
I don't think that is correct, because 7, 10 days or 14 days is normal. In fact, I put it the other way. If he had those signatures and the signatures are genuine and there were 170 of them totally, the other parties today clamoring in court that you have a flow test tomorrow. In fact, this shows that some part of that 170 has been lured by the other side and they are wanting a flow test today because otherwise the horses will go away again.
It could also show that in fact the 170 was never 170 because Ajit Pawar, as I've repeatedly said, misled the governor into claiming that he had 54, that 54 was probably entirely with Sharad Pawar. So, you know, that argument that you're making goes both ways. But let's come out of that.
Yes.
Let me put this to you. The governor's behavior has been roundly criticized. Do you believe there is at least some partial truth to that criticism, or is it entirely unwarranted?
I think it is entirely unwarranted, except I would concede that it's a little odd that it was done in the early hours of the morning. Except that, it's perfectly all right. His decision is correct.
You said two areas are a little odd. One, the haste with which it was done, and B, the early hours. Both are a little odd.
Haste and early hours are together.
Okay. Let's come now to the Prime Minister's role. We've discussed the Governor's role in detail. Let's come to the Prime Minister's role. On receiving the Governor's report recommending the revocation of President's rule at 10 past 2 in the morning, he almost immediately accepted it, forwarded it to the President with his own recommendation, and he did all of this without getting the approval of the Cabinet. Now, I know he has the power to do it without Cabinet's approval. That can be obtained later on. But given that there was no hurry, and given certainly that there was no crisis or urgency, was this proper?
Karan, the fact that there was hurry, urgency, haste, whatever you call it, emanates from the fact that it started at midnight. If it started at midnight, obviously the governor had his reasons to do it as early as possible, because he saw an opportunity.
I'll tell you what the reason was. If I wait till the morning, Sharad Pawar will come and tell me that these MLAs are not with Ajit, they are with me, and suddenly this chance the BJP has to form a government
will
disappear.
That's one way to look at it. The other way is that the two chaps who have come together may not stay together. So he says, you come together now, form the government and prove it in the
floor. So you're suggesting the reason or explanation for why the Prime Minister sent the recommendation without getting Cabinet approval is because the Governor had convinced him there's urgency.
Governor, President. Governor and President of India. Why should the Prime Minister not agree? I'm only presuming.
The President of India came into the picture later, and I'll come to the President in a moment's time. At the moment, I'm questioning that the Prime Minister... The Prime Minister recommended...
No, you're wrong. From the Governor, the communication goes to the President of India.
And then it goes to the Prime Minister.
Then it goes to the Prime Minister. So it went to the President, and the President could have slept over it. So the Governor, the President, and the Prime Minister acted in tandem in this so-called haste, as you say. If all three acted, I take it that all three have some sense of responsibility.
Or all three are bending over backwards to help the BJP come to power, which otherwise it wouldn't. That's
I think it's too strong a charge to put to high functionaries like the Governor, the President and the Prime Minister.
Why? A high functionary is somehow absolved from being put high charges to?
I'm not saying they're absolved. I'm saying that because he started it, the President acted upon it, the Prime Minister rightly therefore granted that exemption.
You made a very important point here, which most people haven't picked up, and I'm just elaborating for a second on it, which is that the Governor's recommendation to remove President's rule was actually first sent to the President.
Yes.
The President sent it to the Prime Minister.
Yes.
And the
That's the law.
And the President himself therefore would have sent it to the Prime Minister after 2:10 at night.
I don't know the exact time.
But the Governor only sent it at 2:10, so the President would have sent it after 2:10 to the Prime Minister, which means all three individuals are involved in this incredible haste with which the revocation of President's rule happened.
The President's role
hadn't been appreciated, now you're bringing our attention to it.
I wouldn't say involved, I would say woken up.
Okay, let me put it like this. Rule 12 of the Transaction of Business Rules gives the Prime Minister power, and I'm quoting, to condone a departure from these rules. But the guidelines make it crystal clear that this should only be used, and I'm quoting again, in a situation of extreme urgency or unforeseen contingency. Neither of those existed. So has the Prime Minister misused Rule 12?
I don't think so. The Prime Minister has absolute power in matters of urgency. Urgency emanates, look at the start of the trail. It emanates from 24th October. Silence till 9th November. Major state in India, commercial capital, no government, nobody comes forward. President rule, one chance to form a government, sends to President. President sends to Prime Minister. Could the Prime Minister have said, I don't care about the government?
Do you really believe that this constitutes extreme urgency?
Yes. Yes. As I told you, every moment of President's rule is an anathema to the democracy.
I know you're the lawyer for Mr. Fadnavis, and therefore you're required to make this argument. But do you really, as a human being, believe that this chronology that you sketched out constitutes extreme urgency?
No
doubt. To me, it sounds like an excuse.
No doubt about it. I think it is urgency. There is an urgency. As I said, the only caveat you could add was, it was a little odd. But suppose it was at 12 at night, 5 in the morning and 10 in the morning, it was okay. It doesn't really matter. These are only matters.
So, to sum up on the role of the Prime Minister, you're saying to me, A, the haste with which he recommended the revocation of President's rule is justified?
Yes.
And secondly, you're saying the use of Rule 12 to avoid...
It's perfectly justified.
It's also justified.
Oh, yes. So you have, that is why, Karan, most important, the petitioners in the Supreme Court, the remaining three parties, did not challenge any of this. All they kept clamoring was, he shouldn't have given oath so fast. Has he? If he has given, do a flow test. Why don't they challenge
it? I'll tell you why they didn't challenge it. Yes. I'm giving you my reason, not theirs. Right. That had they, it would have become a much bigger case and it would have carried on for much longer. And they were interested in an immediate flow test and they wanted to try and ensure that they got it. Had they raised these other issues, they would have expanded the case and they would have not come to a conclusion for many days or weeks.
I don't think so, because it would have, according to them, it would have made their case stronger. A stronger base is always better.
But whether they raise it or not, and whatever their motives for doing so or not doing so is their concern, these are legitimate questions for the public to ask.
Yes.
And you're saying on both those counts, there was no hasty recommending and there was no abuse of rule.
Absolutely, no question.
Let's then come to the president's role. Now, as you pointed out, and people hadn't appreciated this, the president first received the governor's request to revoke after 2:10 in the morning. He then received the Prime Minister's recommendation to go ahead and revoke sometime before 5:47 in the morning. Now, this would lead most people to assume that on that one night, the President was woken up twice.
Maybe.
First at 2:10 and then again just before 5:47.
Yeah, maybe, but they're all
public. But let me finish.
Yes.
And yet, just 13 days earlier, on November the 12th, when President's rule was imposed, the government was quite happy to wait for the President to come back from Punjab to sign the order. Yet, in this instance, shouldn't the president therefore have said, what's the hurry? Why are we doing this at night? Why can't I have a full night's sleep? Why do you keep waking me up?
Look, whether he did it early at night or in the morning is a different thing that he came from Punjab. That's a different thing. Suppose these documents had gone to Punjab, you would have said, why has it gone to Punjab? But if he's very much there, they're all public servants. They're supposed to act in aid of the Constitution. And aid of the Constitution is remove president's rule. How does it matter if it's 2 o'clock at night? We are also woken up at 2 o'clock at night to go and argue a case. So he was also woken up.
Let me put a second concern to you.
Yes.
Should the president have asked the Prime Minister, why have you sent this order to revoke without getting the approval of the cabinet, which is required by the Constitution?
How can he ask the Prime Minister?
Why can't he?
Because the rule allows the Prime Minister to act.
Oh, hang on.
He's not an appellate authority. That's
the third question I'm coming to.
Yeah.
I'll come to it in a moment's time.
Yeah.
First, the President has the right to question an order that's sent to him to sign. And if the Constitution requires that that order should have the approval of the cabinet and it doesn't, the President has a right to say, why doesn't it?
If he had a doubt, he would have done it. Obviously, he had no doubt.
Either he had no doubt or he wished to entertain no doubt.
That I cannot say, because I don't know. But the way it seems to me, the thing emanates much, I mean, starting from, as I said, October, November, governor, president, if it emanates from there, and the letter by the governor to the president, I saw it in the court today, is a very, very detailed letter. It's not a one-line letter.
Okay, let me then put this to you. I'll come to that third question. The president would have been aware that the cabinet has been circumvented because the Prime Minister has invoked Rule 12.
Correct.
Surely he could have said to him, where's the extreme urgency or unforeseen contingency that justifies your doing this?
He could or he couldn't. I mean, it's a matter of his discretion.
And he chose not to.
It doesn't make it illegal.
No, of course it's not.
See, these are only some doubts or shrouds.
Absolutely. None of this makes it illegal. No, but these are questions that would have made the Indian public more confident that the President has asked necessary and raised necessary issues. You expect the president to raise these concerns. He does it not out of his own interest. He does it on behalf of us, our constitution, our democracy. And it seems quite clear he didn't. Has he let the people of India down?
I don't think so. It's too small an issue of 2 o'clock or 5 o'clock in the morning to say let somebody down.
I don't think so. It's not a very confident rebuttal.
I don't think so at all.
I don't think so at all. You're a good lawyer.
Karan,
You're a good lawyer.
This is too small an issue of 2 o'clock or 5 o'clock. I mean,
Let me put it like this. When the president took office, he swore an oath to defend and protect the Constitution. In this instance, has he done it or has he only done it inadequately?
I think he has done it. There's nothing inadequate. The oath is taken by all three. The governor, the president and the prime minister. And I think all of them acted realizing that a government needs to be formed, the rule must go. President's rule must go, which means that the governor loses the right to govern. Normally, a governor would stick on because he's all in all in the government.
Except that this is a governor who was a former BJP chief minister, and if he's getting an opportunity to put into place a prime chief minister from his former party, he'd be only too happy to do it. And no, he knows he pleased the prime minister like by
to be,
doing it.
Would he not like to be a surrogate chief minister himself? By saying, I'm the governor.
Not at
I'm
the cost ruling. Of incurring the wrath of the Prime Minister and Mr. Yeah. Amit Shah. You know it and I know it. But let's leave that aside. Let me put this to you. In 1975,
yes.
former President Fakhruddin Ali
Ahmad signed
the order declaring an emergency in the late dark hours of the night. He was sharply criticized. How is what President Kovind has done any different?
But Karan, what a far cry between the two. Levying an emergency, suspending fundamental rights, putting people in jail, no freedom of speech, millions of people in jails was a horrific time.
Except it was like a Nazi era. Fact that when you have to declare an emergency, there is presumed to be a crisis in the country.
Yeah.
That probably justifies midnight action.
No, not
when you're revoking president's rule.
No, I don't think so, because what you are doing is virtually suspending the constitution. Here, it's swearing in one government. One chap and telling him, now prove it within 10 days or 7 days, there is, or if you have a barometer or a scale of 10, that is 9 on 10 and this is 1 on 10.
Let's no come comparison. At this point to the 10th schedule of the Constitution.
Yeah.
Section 2A says, and I'm quoting, a member of a house shall be disqualified if he has voluntarily given up his membership of his party. Now, my question is simple. Does the anti-defection law kick in as soon as the Election Commission officially notifies the election results? Or does it only kick in when an elected MP takes the oath of the Assembly?
No,
because only then does he become
no,
a member.
No, it will kick in upon the notification of the Election Commission.
So you don't have to wait for the oath to be taken?
No. But obviously, you don't have to wait. But obviously, the disqualification commences when there is a speaker in place.
No doubt.
That's all.
But you made a very important point, and I'm underlining it. You're saying to me as a former Attorney General and you're saying to me as Devendra Fadnavis' lawyer that the anti-defection law kicks in the moment the Election Commission notifies the results.
Yes.
And you don't have to wait for the elected member to take the Assembly's oath.
But effectively it's the same, because the Speaker will come in only when people take the oath.
But
so you can start the case.
No, but don't you see the point I'm making?
Yeah,
that now Sharad Pawar could actually argue that these people were elected on an NCP ticket and they've deliberately gone against what the NCP wants, and they have ended up voting or supporting a government we don't support. Suddenly, the basis has been
created. Which power do we believe? One power says what you say, the other power says that I am the leader of the legislative party and I have decided to support the BJP government. He's not joined the BJP government.
Okay, this is now leads to the other issue that I want to raise with you. Who was deemed to be leader of the legislature party of the NCP as of today, the 25th of November? And my question is very simple.
Yes,
let me go back to first principles.
Yeah.
Does a political party have the right to change its legislature party leader if the majority of the legislators have voted to do so?
Yes, they can change. But the question is, does the other power have the right to change? Because this power says that he is the leader of the legislative party and all 54 people are with him. According to him, he has the party.
It's not the other Pawar who changed Ajit Pawar. It's now officially known and confirmed that over 40 out of the NCP's 54 MLAs voted 24 hours ago that Ajit Pawar would cease to be legislative party leader and the place will now be taken by Jayant Patil. Over 40 of 54 MLAs voted for that.
See,
this is a power that lies not with Sharad Pawar, but it lies with the legislature party. It's voted.
So you have two positions. 24 hours earlier, 54 are with Ajit Pawar. 24 hours later, 40 or 45 are with the other party.
53 actually, but
all right, 53,
over 40 voted in this instance.
Over 40. Whom to believe?
So
these 40 or those 50?
No, just a moment. When the Assembly convenes,
yes,
because that's when it becomes critical,
yes,
who will be deemed to be the legislature party leader of the NCP?
I cannot comment, but it is clear to me that there is going to be a conflict.
Obviously, but given that the legislature party has met all of 24 hours ago and democratically removed Ajit Pawar and appointed Jayant Patil,
well,
under law, Jayant Patil now is the legislature party leader.
Well, all I can say is, I don't know the how their arithmetic is working, but the lawyer for Ajit Pawar said in court, and I'm not their lawyer, he said in court today that he represents the NCP and he is the legislative party leader, and the other Pawar or the other people have no right to remove those 40 signatures are obtained by fraud, by this, that or the other. So I don't know what's going to happen. It's the floor will decide.
I know that Ajit Pawar claims to be the NCP.
That, yes.
It's a bit like the French king saying,
yes.
I'm the state.
Yes.
Right? It's
yes.
a bit presumptuous and bumptious, but leave that aside.
Yes.
The point I'm making is this. If 41 out of 54 NCP MLAs have voted out Ajit Pawar and voted in Jayant Patil, and they've done it democratically, then Jayant Patil, in law, has to be the new legislature
but
party
then,
leader.
But then what happens to the support given by the erstwhile legislative party leader with 54 people to Fadnavis?
It becomes infructuous because the legislature party has a right to change its leader whenever it wants.
Look,
and if it's voted by majority to do so, it's possible that Ajit Pawar was the leader at the time that he committed their support.
And he was changed.
But he was changed. Now he's not.
Look, on the floor of the house, how those 54 people behave will decide.
But
not whether it is Patil or whether it is Patil.
And I accept the point you're hinting at, that it's quite possible on the floor of the house that those 54 who are claiming to be with Sharad Pawar could end up being with Ajit Pawar.
That's what I'm saying.
Time alone will tell.
Yes.
But, and this is the important point, it's a very important point. If those 54 stay with Sharad Pawar, Ajit Pawar ceases to be legislature party leader.
Then he will have no meaning if all 54 go to Sharad Pawar.
And automatically that vote of confidence is
will
lost.
Will fail, yes, correct.
On the other hand, if Ajit Pawar tries to get these people successfully to vote in sufficient number for Fadnavis, Sharad Pawar can say to the speaker that they have breached the ticket on which they were elected. The anti-defection law kicks in from the day the election
yes.
commission notified.
Yes.
Therefore, they are guilty of defection. And they may have brought Fadnavis to power, but they could end up losing their own seats in the assembly.
Well, if he does that, anti-defection case will start. It's like a case. The speaker is a judge. He has to hear parties.
And the speaker can prolong it as well.
Well,
but assuming none of those gimmicks happen,
yes.
at the end of the day, these people could end up voting for Fadnavis and securing his chief minister at the cost of their own MLA.
Could. God knows. See, facts are dynamic. I mean, I did that case recently, 1 month ago, about the Karnataka legislators. You know, there's some 18 of them. So these are dynamic
situations. Yeah, but you know the interesting conclusion we're coming to? That these 54, if they choose to vote with Ajit Pawar in favor of Fadnavis, could very credibly end up endangering their own seats in the assembly.
No, but see, Karan, if all 54 are together, who is the one who will ask for anti-defection? There's nothing left.
But quite clearly, we know that quite clearly all 54 won't be together. So there's a real danger that these 54 could end up supporting Fadnavis but losing their seat.
You require two-thirds
at the moment,
to break away.
At the moment, Ajit Pawar is in glorious isolation. I know Churchill thought glorious isolation
yes,
in the
yes.
Second World War was a winning position.
Yes.
It ain't necessarily for Ajit Pawar.
Right. Let's see. Only time will tell. It's very difficult to
this
say.
This has been a fascinating interview, Mr.
Rohatgi,
and I'm deeply grateful
you.
That you have been willing to go through this entire subject in such exhaustive detail. Thank you very much indeed.
Thank you. Thank you, Karan. Bye.
To receive instant updates on all videos from The Wire, click the subscribe button and hit the bell icon. Pay to support independent journalism. Click the link in the description and choose the amount you want to pay.